We have a wonderful panel for you tonight, and as Anna already mentioned, we will start by listening to Mama Lambert, who is herself a survivor of the genocide in Rwanda that took place 21 years ago. And she will give the introduction herself, so I will not do that, but I think it is good to mention to this audience that she actually wrote a book about her life story. And that book is entitled For Those Who Do Not Believe in Miracles. And it was published by Wolf Legal Publishers, and the publisher is also here with us. And she got some help with the writing of the book and also the translation from Hans Dekker, who is sitting in front. Welcome also to you. And Brigitte Maras, who did the translation from French to Dutch. So welcome also to you. And there are no copies yet of the book tonight, but there will be very soon available through Wolf Legal Publishers. Now, next to Mama Lambert, you will see Mr. Herbert, who is here tonight to translate the first part of the evening. Because what we have done, we will start the evening by listening to Mama Lambert's story on the justice processes and her experiences there. And that will be translated by Mr. Herbert. Now, after the break, we will talk about forgiveness, and we will talk about Mama Lambert's own experiences with her forgiveness process, and that part she will do in English. But for this part, before the break, there will be translation. Now, we also have two excellent speakers from academia who are sitting now in front of me, but later will be joining us in the panel. Welcome to you as well, Dr. Riel Vermoent, who is a professor in Leiden University, and he is a social psychologist who is an expert on justice-related topics. I can give you a whole CV, which I will not do. We also discussed that. But for his outstanding academic work, he has received a Lifetime Achievement Award, and one of his famous books is entitled The Good, the Bad, and the Just, How Modern Men Shape the World. Later you will hear all about his views on justice and forgiveness. Can you please stand up a little bit so that the audience can already see you? Okay. And then we have another foreign guest from Scotland, Dr. Alan Moore, just back from, maybe stand up as well. He just came back actually from Rwanda, where he followed or participated in one of the study tours that also our university organizes each year. Now, Alan is a lecturer in criminal justice and criminology. So we have a social psychologist and a criminologist. And he works at the School of Media, Culture and Society at the University of West of Scotland, I should say. He has many areas in which he is an expert. I will also not list that entire, all these areas, but it's amongst others victimology, criminal justice, human rights, and public international law. So also for you, a very warm welcome. Let's start the program now. We will first listen for some 25 minutes to Mama Lambert's story. So I give the floor to you.
Kuganira. Kubyerekeranye n'ubutabera ndetse no gutanga imbabazi.
She's happy to be here, and she's happy for your presence here today, as we remember in the spirit of forgiveness and justice.
Iki gihugu twakigiriyemo umugisha kuko kudufata mu mugongo byatumye dusubiza amaso inyuma dusanga turoroherwa mu bitekerezo.
We are glad that Netherlands has been our sole companion in this journey of remembrance and forgiveness, because through Netherlands we've been able to realize most of our dreams and achievements.
Nkuko bababwiye nitwa Mama Lambert ariko siko nahoze nitwa.
As they told you, I'm called Mama Rambe, but that's not my original name.
Mama Rambe ni izina rya mateka ya genocide.
Mama Rambe is a name of the history of the genocide history.
Date ari yanyise Beata.
My birth name is Beata.
Beata bivuga ufite amahirwe uhiriwe.
Beata, in translation, it's the blessed one.
Nari mpiriwe koko, nari mfite ababyeyi, nari mfite abavandimwe, nari mfite umugabo, nari mfite abana, nari ntunze ntunganiwe, nari mfite akazi, nari mpiriwe koko.
Indeed, I was blessed. I had a family, I had children, I had a husband, I had I had loving parents, I had a job, I was blessed.
Ariko genocide yaragitwara byose hafi ya byose.
But the 1994 genocide against the Tutsi came and wiped all that away.
Turihuta ndavuga mu nshamake papa baramutemye mu bice bitatu bajugunya mu mugezi witwa Nyabarongo.
I'll be quick. My father was hacked to death in three pieces and thrown and the pieces were thrown in the river called Nyabarongo.
Mama bamujugunyemo nawe muri Nyabarongo hari gihe kimvura uruzi ruramujugunya agaruka hakuno adapfuye asubiye mu rugo baramwica bamuta mu cyobo cya metro 10.
My mother was thrown live in that river called Nyabarongo, but lucky enough she wasn't taken away by the river, but when she, by God's will, she managed to survive. When she returned home, they killed her, threw her in a ditch of 15 meters.
Umugabo bamutwaye ku itariki 21 na magingo na nubu banze kutwereka aho bajugunya umurambo bamaze kumwica.
Her husband was taken on the 11th of April, and till today they failed to reveal where they dumped his body.
Nari mfite abantu 8, batanu barabica, ndokokana na dutatu duto.
She had 8 children, of whom 5 were killed, and now she survived with 3.
Nabashije kubashyingura bo uwabishe yarireze yemera icyaha turi buvuga hatoya. Anyerekaho babajugunye nabashije kubashyingura abo batanu.
Of the 5, she managed to properly bury them after the one who killed them revealed where he had dumped their bodies. So they are buried, she buried them.
Abo na twavaga indi imwe nta n'umwe uriho n'igege nyine warokotse kwa data.
Her siblings all perished. She's the only one surviving in her whole family.
Amazu barasenya nari mfite amazane barayasenya yose barambika hasi inka barazirya ibintu barasahura mbese genocide nsiga wa wundi waruhiriwe abaye umunyabyago.
All her property, houses, she had 4 houses, they're all destroyed, her cows are all eaten, and her being blessed now came a curse.
Narokotse mu buryo bw'igitangaza cy'Imana iyo ntekereje ko mpumeka nzamurira Imana icyubahiro kuko urupfu nararubonye ariko sinapfa.
My surviving was because of God's will. I saw death in front of me, but by God's will I survived.
Aho ndokoke rero nkumva gupfa bindutiye kubaho.
And from the point of my survival, I feel death, I mean, she felt death was better than surviving or better than living.
Nari mfite uruhinja muri genocide twamaranye amezi 3 twiruka mu bihuru twiruka mu mvura nyinshi Lambert.
By the time of the genocide she had a young daughter called Rambert.
A young boy called
Lambert, and they spent 3 months running through the bushes, through the heavy rain, running till the genocide was stopped.
Bampamagara Beata izina ryanjye nkabwira nti sinkiri Beata byararangiye.
And when they would call her by her name, Beata, she would reply, I'm not Beata, that period is past.
Beata utagifite ikintu na kimwe mujye mwicecekera ntimukampamagare sindiho.
Because she had no feeling of Beata with nothing. Beata who had something now is Beata with nothing. Stop calling me Beata.
Umwe mu bo twari turokokanye aravuga ati basireka tukwite mama Rambere bivuga nyina wa Rambere.
And one of the people she managed to survive with insisted to name her at least Mama Lambert instead of being nameless.
Nange natekereza ibitangaza Imana ikoreye imbere y'amaso yanjye tukabaho na Lambert nari ntwaye ntyakara mfiri karapfuye mbese ndavuga nti afazari mupfe kuvuga muti nyina wa Lambert tujye tugendana dutyo.
And she accepted being called Mama Rambert because looking at her situation with the baby boy she had carried all those 3 months through the rain, through the heavy pour, she accepted to be called Mama Rambert.
Sinzire nkagenda nyurangatanamo n'abaduhigaga biranshanga biranyobera pe.
She couldn't sleep. All the way she was going, she would come across people who were actually looking for her to kill her and her and Rambert.
Ntanubwo narebaga Rambert niberaga mu bapfuye ngahamagara umugabo wanje ngahamagara Joyeuse wo imfura yanjye ngahamagara Claudette ngahamagara Jérime ngahamagara Olivier ngahamagara abana banjye nkabahamagara simbashe gusinzira.
She couldn't sleep as for the whole night she would always keep on recalling and calling her husband, all her 5 children were killed, just calling them psychological torture.
Numvaga ntegereje ubutabera kureba ikintu bazakorera abo batwiciye niho ngeze mu butabera.
At the time all she wanted was justice for the ones who killed her family.
Burya rero iyo utigeze ubona ubutabera wumva utaza aho uherereye.
Without getting justice, it is so hard for you to determine where you are in such a situation.
59 mfite imyaka 7 nabwo babigenje batyo habaye umwami amaze gupfa hagiyeho Parmehutu nabwo baradutwikiye barica ntitwabona ubutabera.
In 1959, when she was 7 years old, a similar situation happened when after the death of the king, a certain party called Parmehutu came to power. They killed, they destroyed, they rooted, but there was no justice.
Icyo yahubwa bishe n'abari inka n'abatwitse barabagororeye baba ba burgomestre baba ba sous-préfet baba babona imyanya ikomeye.
And at the time in 1959 those who killed were rewarded with heavy posts, with heavy posts in the government, given other high jobs just because of the killing.
Icyo gihe nabwo bi passe na perceive baravuga ngo ibibaye birabaye turongera turakomeza nyine tubana nabo turongera tugwa neza turabihorera ariko nirindwi n'itatu biragaruka nanone ntibahanwa ahubwo baragororerwa byari byaratuyobeye ibyo ari byo pe.
And because of the Rwandan nature we tend to forgive, so when it happened they said okay, it has happened, what has happened has happened, let's unite and be together. They live together. However, in 1973 the same happened and there was no justice.
Burya rero icyo ubutabera bukora bukumira umuntu wese ushaka kugira nabi, bukumira ubugizi bwa nabi.
The essence of justice is to prevent one who wants to do wrong and is to prevent one who wants to do wrong.
Iyo utahanye hagumiriza ku wa wundi wakoze nabi yumva ari uburenganzira bwe, yumva ntacyo ibyo bivuze, yumva atanuba umuntu.
If you don't do justice, the criminal or the culprit feels like it's his right to do wrong all the time.
Niko byari byaratugendekeye twumvaga ari uburenganzira bw'abahutu kwica abatutsi kuko batahanwaga.
And that's how we felt, because it was like a normal business for, and we felt that the Hutu were, it was their right to kill the Tutsi, and nothing was to be done.
Bataye ubumuntu muri 1994 bakoze ibintu bigaragaza yuko iyo wakoze n'abahugugororerwa ukumva nta gikumira ibibi iyo nta butabera nta kintu gikumira ibibi.
And for them to get the energy that they used in the genocide was because they had this feeling that whenever you do wrong, there's no justice, there's nobody going to punish you. So it was like a normal routine, just killing normal routine.
N'abatutsi bageze aho ngaho babona ko icyaba ari ugupfa nyine, babona ko igihe umuntu ashakiye abica.
And even at a certain point, the Tutsi felt like, yes, it's all right, now we have to die, because Hutus have the right to kill, and nothing was being done in the justice sector.
Kuko 59 n'itandatu gatatu ntabwo bakunze kwica abana n'abagore, ariko muri 1994 n'umwana wari mu nda barasaturaga bakamuvanamo ngo barebe inzoka uko imeze mu nda kandi ari umuntu batuma umuntu.
Because in 1959 and 1963 they were not killing women and children, but in 1994 things turned around. They started killing children and women to the point of bisecting a pregnant woman to see the snake, as they used to term the Tutsis, to see the snake, just bisecting her and kill the baby and the mother.
Abazasura mu Rwanda muzabibona n'utwana duto duto twababwiraga ngo sinzongera kuba umututsi kandi yaravutse ari umututsi wabirekute. Abavugaga ngo ndakurega kuri papa, abavuga batari bazi ubwoko, batari bazi icyo ari cyo, nabo baratinyutse bakabakubita ku bikuta by'inzu nk'uko.
For those of you who get a chance to visit Rwanda, you'll see that at a certain point, children who were young children or babies, those who are just being cut out of their mother's stomachs, were being killed just because they were Tutsi.
Ubutabera bushyira umuntu abantu ku murongo.
So justice is there to put people in the proper order.
Ubutabera burenganura nyamuke.
And justice is there for the weak.
Ubutabera burenganura abanyantege.
Justice is there for the poor, for the weak.
Ubutabera bugorora ibyari bigoramye bikajya ku murongo.
Justice is there to put things in the proper channel, in the proper way.
Ubutabera burunga.
Justice unites.
Ubutabera butuma n'uwari ugambiriye gukora ikibi ahagarara akagira agafata feri.
Because of justice, it prevents the one who is going to do a crime.
Ariko hatari ubutabera bararushanwa mu gukora ibibi, bakavuga ati nanaka kwatahanwe, nanaka kwata, bakarushanwa gukora ibibi.
But in a situation where there's no justice, people are in competition. Criminals or culprits are in competition to do wrong, to do crime.
Kudahanwa byatumye bishora mu bwinshi mu bwicanyi bw'igihe cya genocide.
Because there was no justice, it encouraged the genociders to get into the act of killing massively.
Muri 1994 bishoyemo ari benshi, abana, abasore, abagore, abagabo, bishoyemo, bituma rero no kubahana bigora.
In 1994, massive children, men, women, the old, all engaged into the acts of killing, to the acts of genocide, leading to the hardships in providing justice.
Ubutabera bugarura na wa wundi wakoze icyaha agatekereza akicara akamenya ibibi bye.
And the advantage of justice is that it brings back the memories, it brings back the culprit in proper line of thinking and provides him the opportunity to ask for forgiveness.
Ubutabera bufavoriza n'abantu, bituma gusaba imbabazi bibaho, kuko noneho yicara agatekereza, ubutabera bumwereka ifoto ye yayibona kigaya agasaba imbabazi.
And because of justice, the criminal or the culprit feels shame and guilt of the crimes he did.
Niyo mpamvu ubuyobozi bwacu bwatekereje baravuga bati ibyo ari byo byose ikibi ntigikize ikibi reka aba bantu turebe ko batekereza hanyuma bashyiraho inkiko gacaca zicimanza ariko zikanunga.
That's why our government, the Rwandan government, foresaw that wrong shouldn't be rewarded with wrong, but rather established the Gacaca courts, where people were brought together to confess their crimes and seek forgiveness.
Ibyaha aho byakorewe bibariho ubutabera bubera.
At the exact spot where the killings took place, that's where the courts were conducted, and that's where everything was being was conducted.
Ugacirwa urubanza n'umuryango wawe uhari n'ababirebaga bahari na nyirukubikorerwa hari na nyirukubikora hari bari kuri uwo musozi aho byakorewe.
And the cases would be decided from the very spot that you, the culprit, you, the survivor, your family members, and the community are sitting and all judge you, the culprit, according to what you did.
Ndashimira cyane umukobwa w'intwari Anne Marie, nababwiye ko nta muryango nari mfite, numvaga mfite ubwoba bwo kongera guhura n'uwampemukiye, wanyiciye abana, ndi jyenyine. Ndamushimira cyane ko yamperekeje, nawe akabasha no kureba abo bicanyi.
I thank very much, she calls her a hero, Anne Marie, who managed to escort her all the way through the Gacaca courts, because Mama Rambe was scared of meeting the perpetrators who killed her family. But Anne Marie escorted her through all the way in the Gacaca courts.
Mu by'ukuri ntabwo nabona ukuntu mbabwira ko n'umwicanyi ahagaze imbere yawe. I am sorry, it is an example. Umwicanyi ahagaze imbere yawe ukamwibuka kwicira abana, ukamwibuka kwicira umugabo, ukamwibuka kwicira ababyeyi, ukamwibuka ahagaze umuryango we bose bari hariya, wowe uhagaze uraho wenyine. Nacyo cyari ikizamini.
It's hard for her to express her feelings at that point where she stood face to face with the killers of her whole family, while the killer's family is standing there. So it was another cross to carry, seeing the killer's family and the killer himself in front of you, and you're standing alone, knowingly that your whole family perished because of this person.
Ukabona umuntu wagufashe ku ngufu akakwanduza sida muriho muri murebana.
Seeing somebody who raped you, infected you with HIV, now you're looking at him face to face.
Cyari ikizamini.
It was a heavy exam to face.
Ariko ubutabera bwa gacaca bwatweretse ingero ebyiri z'abicanyi.
But because of Gacaca, we managed to identify two categories of killers.
Abaca bugufi bagasaba imbabazi uretse ko ari bake.
Those who confess their crimes and seek for forgiveness despite the fact that they are few.
N'abandi bahakana akavuga ko nta genocide yabaye.
And those who still deny that there was no genocide.
Ukibaza utese uyu ko namubonye n'amaso yanjye cyangwa agahakana akavuga ko mutigeze muhura. Uyu ko namubonye n'amaso yanjye ko nahoranye umugabo, ko nahoranye abana, ko nahoranye amazu, ko nahoranye. Uyu arahakana ati agahakana ukabona arahakanya nangiye umutima.
And what hurts is seeing somebody denying that genocide didn't happen, yet you exactly know you saw him kill your family, kill your husband, kill all your children, but still he says there was no genocide.
Cyangwa akavuga amagambo agutoneka aho kugira ngo bibe ubutabera bwunga, akavuga amagambo agutoneka ngo namutemye ijosi musigaho, namuteye icyuma ntiyapfa ndigendera, yari yanze gupfa munogonora ngo ashiremo umwuka yo gupfa nabi. Bakavuga ibintu bigutoneka bishobora no
kugukomeretsa cyane.
Or instead of denying genocide, instead of denying genocide, one tarnishes the genocide image by just saying that I just cut him on the neck and I didn't kill him. I stabbed him, I didn't kill him. Or I killed him because he intended to die. Something that actually to frustrate you.
Ndemera ko namufashe ku ngufu nari nanduye nari ndwaye sida nawe barayifite kandi retira muvuza ukumva nta muri we nta kwihana.
Accepting, you know, just saying, yes, I raped her, I infected her with HIV, the government is helping them, so what? And he stops there. So that's what's hurting them more.
Aho mutazabona ubutabera muzamenye ko igihugu kiri mu kaga.
A country with no justice is a doomed country.
Cyana zima burundu.
And it will be doomed forever.
Nubu dufite uruvugiro kuko dufite leta yacu nziza yaduhaye ubutabera bwunga tubasha gushyingura abacu mu butabera bakatwereka aho babataye n'ukuri icyo nababwira mushimangire ubutabera kuko nibwo butuma abantu baba bantu.
Today we have a voice because our government has managed to give us justice. We've managed to bury our beloved ones in proper places. Please, please, please always seek justice.
Murakoze cyane kudutega amatwi twumva iyo umuntu aguteza amatwi nabwo abaguhaye agaciro. Murakoze cyane.
We thank you very much for your kind attention, because when you listen to our speeches and our testimonies, we feel touched and blessed. Thank you.
Before we go to the discussion, we thought it to be a very good idea to also have a lighting of the candle ceremony, as it is called, because this is also the period of the official period of commemoration in Rwanda. So I will speak out some of the official words, and then I will ask Mama Lambert and our ambassador and Anna to light the candle. So we will now take some time to commemorate the innocent lives lost. We remember the hundreds of thousands of people who lost their lives 20 years ago in Rwanda. In particular, we would like to pay tribute here to the family members of Mama Lambert, her husband, Placide Rujahana, her children, Joyeuse, Claudette, Germain, Ruta Gitsire, and Olivier, her parents, Eligier and Marie, her sisters and brothers and their families, her grandmother, aunts, uncles, nieces, nephews, cousins, and friends. That these crimes may never be committed again, anywhere in the world. We pray for Mama Lambert and others like her, who have shown great commitment, strength, and inspiration for many genocide survivors, who did no longer feel like living. May she continue to find this strength. We are now going to listen to one song related to the genocide in Rwanda against the Tutsi. And the song in Kinyarwanda is about bringing comfort to others. And it's called Humura.
We bire birarura abahembe ingenga bitekerezo yayo muramenye mumenye ko rwanda tarindire yukicanye no ahugaringa byo duhetse twese nk'abanyarwanda
for taking part in this. I would like to invite the two of you now to come to the stage. Now, we've been just listening to Mama Lambert talking about how she actually views justice and how it unites, how it can put people back in the right order, as you mentioned it. I would like to hear first from our social psychologist. What is your reaction to her view on her very personal story on justice?
It is, of course, difficult to listen to those very, very, very sad stories about the atrocities that were committed in Rwanda 21 years ago. But Madame Lambert, in her way of thinking, is still has a recognition of what justice is. One of her sentences was, justice is to put the people in the proper way, in a proper place. The other one is, justice is for the weak, for the poor. Justice unites. These are different ways of looking at justice. And the first one, putting people in the proper place, is something that reminds me or connects me with the way I see justice in the work I did in the last 25 years. Justice, for me, is in fact that there is a feeling, first of all. It's a feeling that there is a balance between what you keep for yourself and give to others. There must be some balance. That may be equally that you give something to yourself or keep for yourself a gift to others. There must be a balance between it. If you kill other people, it's totally unjust. It's an atrocious thing. You don't do that. But this idea of giving to self and giving to other, that can be done in economic terms, that can be money or that can be goods, but also respect. You give respect to yourself versus you give respect to the other. And there must be a balance between it. If you give too much respect to yourself, you are a narcissistic person. If you give too much respect to the other, you are a doormat. So there must be a balance between those two. But also in terms of love or affection, There must be a balance between what you give to yourself a bit, what you give to others. And also care. Care, giving care is, must be a balance between what you give to yourself, you keep to yourself, and give to others. The whole discussion now in the Netherlands about care, etc., etc., is something that has to do with the vision of what time and care you give to other people.
Can I ask you a little bit further about how you, from your own research, link this to this balance in the justice processes? Does that mean that from the results in your research that actually the restorative justice approach might be more appropriate to get that balance, or would that be too much of an overstatement?
No, the ideal is to get that balance. And in most cases, it's equality. You give so much to yourself as you give to the other, or give to the other, or give to yourself. But in modern society, we don't do that. We have not the idea that, for instance, a person with higher education will certainly earn more than a person with lower education. But we all accept it. And we even say, yes, that's fair. That's just. Why is that? Because we have reasons. Reasons that education is so important that it may be, that it can be rewarded more than no or lesser education. That's what we, all of us, agreed upon. And that becomes another way of thinking of justice. The inequality becomes an equality by, evaluating education more than, for instance, working hard or working in bad circumstances. Mm-hmm. That is the idea. So we as a society, we deviate every time from equality.
And is that something you also see within the criminal justice system? Or, and then I'll go to our next speaker.
In the criminal justice system, we see exactly the same. Someone who has done a big crime is punished more than someone who has committed a lesser crime. We don't say it's a crime. You have done something wrong, so we punish you equally. No, we say, there's more, thus you get more. Mm-hmm. And that is, yeah.
I wonder what the criminologist thinks about that, because that's quite a statement, maybe. If you, also based on your experience being in Rwanda, but also in the domestic sphere in your own country, how do you, what is your idea of justice? When do you find this proper balance? When does it indeed unite, as Mama Lambert has expressed?
I honestly find it very difficult to have an overarching definition of what you call justice when it comes to criminal justice. Before I went to Rwanda, the literature review that I produced was based on trying to define justice. And it's so hard. For anyone that studied justice, criminal justice, any sort of justice, social justice, it's such a difficult concept to define. Justice can be very, very different from one person to another, depending on the types of crimes that have been committed against them, depending on the length of victimization, depending on even things like the age or gender of the victim or the perpetrator. And as a result, what somebody wants out of justice can really be different. So, you know, you have restorative justice we've talked about, you've got distributive justice, you've got retributive justice, you've got punitive justice, all different types of justice. And, you know, from my perspective, looking at what victims want, it's very difficult to find a clear dialogue. There are some clear threads that do come out. So when I read the accounts of a number of survivors from Rwanda, for example, you had some survivors that said, for example, you know, if you live by the spear, you die by the spear. If you live by the sword, you die by the sword. It should be an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But then there are other accounts of survivors who say, you know, killing somebody isn't justice because that doesn't bring back your own relatives. It doesn't heal the wounds that you have. And likewise, imprisoning somebody, unless you're talking about life meaning life, eventually they come out of prison. But if they still harbour those ideologies, now when it comes to Rwanda, that's obviously a genocide ideology. But when it comes to any sort of crime, somebody could have some sort of view, and if that's not changed, then justice hasn't been served.
And if you take now your experience from Rwanda, where you've been listening to people who were participating in the Gacaca and who have been part of the officials, can you say something about your own estimation or evaluation of that process? Would that be a fair balance that was trying to be met there, if even you can answer that question?
Well, it's a different system. The Gacaca system, as anyone knows about it, will tell you, of course. Unlike jury systems, for example, in Europe, where the majority of the time those that are judging somebody on their crimes have no awareness of this individual. In fact, often it's a crime to even discuss those crimes in the public prior to going into the courtroom. You're told to judge somebody based purely on the facts that are presented to that courtroom at that time. Now, the Gacaca system, of course, is based on the notion that it is those from the community that know the people, that know whether it's the perpetrators, the survivors, then judging that individual, you know, as Mama Lambert said, in the very spots that these crimes took place. So there's a very, very personal link there. Now, from a justice perspective, of course, the difficulty is trying to minimise bias in that location, in that environment, trying to say that somebody's personal feelings won't come into the situation. It's very, very difficult to stop that happening.
But what do you mean, as in jeopardising maybe rights for the defendant, or as in the bias? Where do you see the bias coming in within the Gacaca procedure?
Well, theoretically, both. But at the same time, now, I had this discussion with a number of people that were on the study trip. We had the discussion about what system would be perfect. Now, the problem is, you can conceptually create a perfect justice system, but in reality, that might not work. Now, for example, you talk about the genocide in Rwanda. At the end of the genocide in Rwanda in 1994, there were, I think, around about 250 people from the legal profession, from the judiciary, still alive, of which approximately 200 were living in diaspora. So they had, you know, been displaced to other countries, to Tanzania, to Burundi, to the Congo, etc. And there were less than 50 members of that judiciary left in the country to actually deal with the aftermath. Now, when you're talking about the number of regions, the number of areas to be covered, the question has to be, well, using a conventional justice system, an existing justice system, how do you then deal with the workload you have to deal with? And the answer is very simple. You can't. It's impossible. So what Rwanda had to do was design a system that was the best justice system they could under the circumstances, that would be effective, that absolutely would not be foolproof. But then the international community often seems to criticise the system based on some of these biases without thinking about the reality. Well, the reality is, if you went with a conventional justice system, you know, experts say it would have taken anywhere between 50 and 130 years to try all of the suspects. Now, obviously, that's an impossibility. So some people would never see justice. You know, survivors, victims' families, etc., would never see justice being done. And likewise, the perpetrators wouldn't come to justice.
Was it because we've had these discussions many times, and often what you see is that Western scholars criticize systems, in this case in Rwanda, without any knowledge of the country, without ever having been there, and measuring it against, for instance, human rights instruments. And my question to you, final question to you, is, was it important for you to go to Rwanda to come to this understanding, or was that for you something also before this visit that you had as a overarching idea of how you should deal with these complexities and then find an effective or efficient justice system? So did you need the Rwanda visit to come to this this view?
Yes. The short answer is yes. I would say that it's very important to go. I think that obviously you can learn a lot from literature, especially in the modern age where it's, you know, information is relatively easy to get hold of. But the danger of that, of course, is that any quality control effectively on literature is also very difficult. So assessing, you know, seeing the wood for the trees and seeing, you know, amongst all of the different stories, narratives, what is the true one, it's very difficult to do from reading alone. And I think even, as I'm sure anyone that has been to the country will verify, it's very difficult to really understand the nature of the problem and the scale of the problem until you've actually visited some of these locations and you see the scale of the issues that resulted from the genocide. Mm. And, you know, the result, of course, is that a huge number of victims have been created and a huge demand for justice as a result.
Mm-mm. So it's a call for everyone working in this area, in the audience, to make sure you go to the area where you're writing or researching or studying on. Is there someone in the audience that would like to pose a very urgent question? We have some time, not too much. We have two students with microphones. Anyone that would like to raise a question? Now is your chance.
So my question would be, is it possible, and if, in what way can we unify these different understandings and ideas of justice in order to obtain to a highest extent justice for people who suffer?
I will pose this question to Dr. Vermont, okay? Or you post it, but I will give you.
Yeah. it's always the question researchers are looking for, that is to try to find a general rule of what is just or unjust, and we can't find it. Because, first of all, it's different between different cultures, what is just or unjust. Secondly, society changes. What was just 50 years ago might be unjust 20 years ago and even now. For instance, let's say of the bankers, okay, that's unjust what they did by providing themselves with a lot of money at the cost of all of us. That's unjust. Maybe that it was over 10 years that we think completely different, that we find it normal that those people get so much money. In the second place, football players, they earn so much money. There's no one who's saying that's unjust. So it depends on the situation, on the culture, and on the time we live in. So a general rule of what is just is not, it is not a Kantian idea of that. Happily not. We are ourselves who define what is just or unjust. That's important.
Yeah, maybe also good to add that from many victimological studies, we also know that victims are not a homogeneous group with all the same needs. So that's also the difficulty that a justice system faces, in order to be able to meet those needs, which are not the same.
Iyo tuvuga ubutabera wumva ufite ishyaka kuko bukurenganura.
When I talk about justice, I feel like I'm excited to talk about it because you know that you get something from justice.
Bukaba n'urukingo rukingira abari bafite umugambi wo gukora nabi.
But also we know that justice is a wall that prevents wrongdoers from putting into practice their wrongdoings.
Ukumva ufite sécurité kuko uwakoze nabi baramuhana akagaruka mu murongo noneho ugakora wumva ntabi nta ufite sécurité.
You feel like you are secure, you feel like you have security because it does punish those who commit wrongs, indeed.
Ariko kubabarira ibikorwa biba byabaye.
But forgiving implies that a wrong did indeed happen.
Ibikorwa byakugiriye nabi.
The wrong deed of someone who did some wrongdoing against you.
ndetse rimwe na rimwe uravuga uti ndacyababarira iki se kandi ndababarira se data na mama ngo bazuke umugabo azuke abana bazuke inzi ihite yuzura ukumva kubabarira ni ikintu gikomeye tunabivuga dufite ubwoba cyane.
But before forgiving, of course, you go through a process. You ask yourself many questions like, should I forgive? But what would that imply? Will I get my husband, my family, my children back? Sometimes you are very insecure at the beginning. And can you imagine forgiving, but the person you forgive, basically you even ask, forgive, refuses to give forgiveness. Let me rephrase. Can you imagine asking for forgiveness, but then the person to whom you ask for forgiveness refuses to give forgiveness? So it's a very difficult test to forgive. You don't learn. Nobody teaches you to forgive.
N'ugutera intambwe ukigira imbere ukava mu byatambutse.
Forgiving is a process. It's taking a step after another in order to move from the wrong which did happen towards some brighter future.
Yeho naranatekerezaga nti sinzumve n'unsaba imbabazi ntacyo kizinsabira.
At a given time I thought, I don't really want to hear someone asking me for forgiveness. I don't want to be there in that spot.
Itanu n'icyenda barashenye dutangirira kuri zero turababarira tubana nabo turasangira tubyarana muri batisimu turasengana ndetse barashyingirana turababarira.
We went through a process and that was the background to that. In 59 crimes were committed, we forgave, and after we lived together as if nothing happened, some even intermarried. We went to churches together, we had baptisms as if nothing happened.
Tukibwira ko byarangiye ariko itandatu gatatu yarongeye biraba hanyuma barongera babandi babaribo nanone bakora basenya barica bakora amarorerwa.
We thought that was over, but in 63 the same happened. The same guys who were involved in crimes in 59 did precisely the same again.
Irindwi n'itatu nari mfite imyaka 20.
In 73, I was 20 years old.
Nahoze nereka abo twari kumwe Hansi na William na Nimari. Nari mfite imyaka 20 banyirukankana ku gasozi ndi umukobwa w'inkumi bavuga ngo baramfata ku ngufu mpishwa n'akagabo kagufi cyane buryo ubugabo si n'ubutumbi gato cyane kanshyira mu nzu na murumuna wanjye na mubyara wanjye gafora umuheto kararasa bariruka. Icyo gihe 73 ndababona neza bo bashakaga kumfata ku ngufu n'abarumuna banjye uretse ko barumuna banjye na mubyara wanjye bazize 94 ariko icyo gihe twarababonye turongera turababarira.
In 73, as I said, there was a group of people who ran after me saying that they were going to rape me, and I saw them, I knew them. And I was saved by a very little short man. So being brave is not nothing to do with hate. It was a very little man who ended up sheltering me, 73, and me and my sisters and relatives. And he had a spare, basically, where he made them run away. But again, after that, we forgave. But of course, those relatives who were sheltered with me in 73 were killed during the genocide in
94.
Our father told us that the Hutus will exterminate us.
We
told our father that will not happen because we have the United Nations. The people who did it asked for forgiveness. The current president promised not to condone the killings because of, like his predecessor. So we felt somehow reassured that will not happen because of all of that.
Turababarira.
We forgave.
Turongera 94 noneho baza bamaraho nkuko papa yari yarabitubwiye yarabibonaga.
But the prediction of my father turned out to be pretty much true, because in 94 indeed they pretty much were close to exterminating people.
Ariko cyatumaga abitubwira yabonaga badahanwa hariho ubwo ubugome buragwira niba ari ukukwica umuntu arakwicira ariko barabanzaga bakabamaramo ubuntu bakabambika ubusa abakecuru bakagendana n'abagabo babo n'abakazana n'abakwe n'abana bato n'abuzukuru mwambaye ubusa bakajya kubicira nko ku birometero 10.
But the reason why it was easy for them to kill was also that because we were somehow dehumanized in the process of killing us. They stripped us of our clothes. We had to go naked, young people together with husbands and young children or grandparents. And in that process, then those who killed us felt like we were fair game.
Data yabibona ati ntimureba aba bantu badahanwa hariho umunsi bazavanaho ikitwa umututsi cyose.
And when our father saw that, he said, as you see this, for sure, in the end, we will end up being exterminated. That was the reason he said that.
Ariko uzi kubabarira umuntu wakubujije kwiga adateze kongera kubigusubiza igihe kiriho ukabana nawe ukamwihorera ukashaka ubundi buzima ukaba umushoferi ukahinga ukorora yarakubujije kwiga.
But in that process, during all of those years, you need to understand what forgiving meant. For example, people were refused to study because of the ethnic policies that were in place. And forgiving basically meant that you are prevented from having that opportunity and had to find some other ways of surviving because you didn't get education. But still, you managed to forgive that person and live with him, doing probably jobs which are under your potential. But if then that person was to ask you for forgiveness, you will say, what did I do to you in order to do all of that to me?
Uko byangendekeye nagiye kubona mbona muri nagendaga mu muhanda ntashakwa n'umbwira ngo mbabarira ngiye kubona muri 98 nyuma y'imyaka 4 genocide yakorewe abatutsi baye mbona urupapuro.
So what happened in my case was that I was, as I said, in a situation where I didn't want to hear anyone asking me for forgiveness. I was not in that state of mind. But in 98, that came in the form of a piece of paper.
Umwe mu bishabana banje witwa Manase yari yanyandikiye asaba imbabazi, avuga abo bari kumwe, avuga uko yabigenje, avuga ibyo yabicishije bibi cyane.
So one of the people who was involved in the killing of my children wrote a letter describing what he did, how they were killed, what weapons were used, who was part of the attacks which killed my children, and he described those. And I can't describe in which state I was when I read that letter.
Uzumuntu wafashe umwana wawe imfura gatema wa kabiri wa gatatu wa kane wa gatanu n'abaturanyi n'abandi n'inshuti nafashe urupapuro maze kurusoma ndaruzingazinga ndujugunya nta suite.
Probably through the description you see what she did of the piece of paper when she read it. Basically, think of the person who killed all of your elder children. By the way, what she said earlier was that those who were killed were all of the elder children. Those who survived were the younger ones. So think of that person who did that. All what I did was I felt like I took the paper and almost shredded it.
Mama we niwe wari wa nyina niwe wari waruzanye ndetse nshaka kwihimura ndavuga nti Manase yanyiciye abana none nange ngiye kwica nyina bihwaniremo.
I even felt vengeful at that time when because it's the mother of the suspect, basically of the person confessing who brought the letter, so the mother of Manase. So I felt like maybe the best solution would be probably to kill him as well. Then at least I will get my vengeance.
Bari abantu bari barataye ubumuntu naramwitegerezaga nkamumva ngiye kumwica nkumva ndetse nta n'uzabimenya ariko umutima urandya.
I felt like they had lost their humanness, and in that sense probably then it was a good thing maybe to get rid of the person because they were no longer humans. But at the same time, my consciousness told me otherwise.
nkatekereza nti ibiganza byanjye bigiye kwambara amaraso y'umuntu.
I felt like then I was about to tie my blood into in my hands into blood.
Irindi jwi rikambwira ati vanaho na Joyeuse na Claudette barabana n'umugabo wawe yari umuntu na vanaho.
On one hand, of course, I felt like I remembered all of my relatives, children, and parents who are dead, and I felt like they were persons as well, and just like him. So maybe if you do that, it's the right thing to do. But at the same time, I felt like it wasn't.
Nababwiye rero yuko murabyemera uko kuko niko byangendekeye mu kuri kose narabanje ndasenga ndavuga ngo ngiye kwica mu kansanga. Munyina wa Manase yitwa Mukansanga ndavuga ngo ngiye kwica Mukansanga mana.
So I knelt and prayed and I said, however horrible that may sound, I'm about to kill Mukansanga, who is the mother of Manase, the person who killed my children.
And I mfata Bibiliya ndambura ntya mu gusenga ndayirambura nsanga handitse ngo ndambuye rimwe nsanga handitse ngo ntihagire uwica Kayini mumureka abikivume ntihagire uzica Kayini amaze kwica mwene nyina Beri. Hari muri Bibiliya ku bakristo murabizi hari ahanditse ngo Kayini abikivume ntihagire umwica.
I suddenly opened the book, the Bible. On the very first page I opened, there was a passage about the killing of Abel by Cain. How do they say in Cain? I have no clue how they pronounce it in English. Cain. But the voice said, don't kill Cain, but let him go away. He will be a cursed person. That's the passage suddenly that I opened.
And I said, hanyuma nza kuvuga ngo na kaga ibisimbishaka iyi Bibiliya nzayisoma amaze kwica Mukansanga.
I even felt revolted somehow, and I felt like probably I should set the Bible aside. I will read about it later on, but I need first of all to do this.
Nza kongera numva ngiza amatsiko ndavuga ngo ariko reka nongere ndebe.
But I took it again and opened again.
Ndongera ndarambura kuko nari maze kuvuga ngo nzababarira tuzababarira tuzageze ryari abatutsi bazababarira bazageze ryari.
Because my feeling was that we had forgiven enough as Tutsis, and I felt like that shouldn't be the case now.
Muri Bibiliya rero harahanditse ni muri Matayo handitse ngo umuntu yabajije Yesu Kristo ngo umuntu azababarire kangahe. Yesu arababwira ngo muzababarire 70 inshuro 70.
In Bible somewhere in Matthew, it's written that someone asked Jesus about how many times one should forgive. And it's written that you should forgive 70 times 7. Yeah. Indeed. 70 times 7.
Ntabwo ari idini cyangwa ubukristo ndiho nigisha, ariko ndababwira uko byagendekeye jyewe.
By the way, I'm not here preaching you to be a believer as I am, but I'm just telling you what happened in my case.
Nibwo natekereje 5, 9, 6, 3, 7, 9, 4 nsanga ngiye kubabarira inshuro 5.
So I ended up counting all of those years from 59, from 63, from 73 again, and I felt like, in fact, I would end up forgiving for the fifth time.
Icyo ni gice kimwe.
That was one side.
Ikindi gice cyatumye mbabarira.
But then also one of the reasons why I ended up forgiving.
Nahoraga mu mutima wanjye numva uburakari.
I felt like a sad and angry person.
Nahoraga mu mutima wanjye ndi kumwe n'abicanyi.
In all my life since surviving, I felt like I lived with the killers.
Najyaga ku meza nti ndiho ndarya umugabo wanjye adahari abana banjye bishwe na Manase nahoranaga na Manase.
I lived in fact with Manase the entire life. Remember, Manase is the killer.
So
when I was at my table, my dining table, Manase was there, because then I felt how I was lonely without my family.
Najya mu isoko cyangwa mu muhanda nkavuga ngo uri usa na Manase ninde.
When I went to the market or anywhere on the road, any person I saw, somehow I saw in the image of that person, I saw Manase.
Manase yamporaga iruhande no mu bitekerezo.
Manase was all over the place in my life, around me, Even in praying in the church, I asked God whether he would be able to forgive Manasseh. All of me was, in fact, Manasseh was all over the place.
Buke yandika indi baruwa rero ya yarangije muri bibiri yandika ibaruwa nibwo nafashe umwanzuro wo kubabarira.
And the climax was that in 2000 he wrote a second letter which led to me forgiving him.
Maze kubabarira numvise amahoro mu mutima.
And once I forgave him, I felt at peace in my heart.
Sinongeye kugendana na Manasseh hose numvise ngomba gutegura ubuzima bwanjye bw'imbere n'ubw'abana nasigaranye nibwo natangiye gutekereza ku buzima bw'imbere.
And once I forgave him, that's when I started really feeling that I should start leaving that stage of my life behind. That's when I started actually thinking on how to plan my life ahead and how to make my children who survived
live.
Forgiving doesn't cost much. You are not bought into forgiving.
Kubabarira n'ugutuma ibitekerezo byawe n'ubuzima bwawe butagengwa n'umwanzi.
In fact, forgiving is ensuring that your thoughts and feelings are not controlled by the wrongdoer.
Kubabarira n'ukurenga n'ukurenga umupaka w'umujinya wo guhora upanga kugirira nabi wa wundi.
Forgiving is in fact a way of crossing the boundary of anger and bad feelings and beef and ideas about doing a wrong yourself.
Akagero gato nabaha iyo uruyukira ukuriye rusigura ubori mu mubiri wawe.
One maybe imagery I can give you is that when a bee basically bites you, it leaves a sting.
Ntiwiruka inyuma y'uruyuki ahubwo urwana no kugira ngo uvanemo rwa rubori rwagushyize mu mubiri.
But the best way to heal is not to run after the bee which did bite you, but rather to remove the sting that was left in your body.
Kubabarira ni ukuvanamo buriya bugome buriya aba yaguteye ukabuvana muri wowe noneho ukabona ugakomeza.
So forgiving also is all about you removing all of the bad feelings, all of the anger that you have that was left in you, and learn how to move forward.
Nirukaga inyuma ya Manasseh, nirukaga inyuma ya nyina wa Manasseh, ariko aho mbishyiriye ku ruhande ni nka rwa rubori mvanyemo narebye ubuzima bwanjye n'ubw'abana banjye.
I used to run after Manasseh, having my mind populated by Manasseh, but once I did, or the mother of Manasseh for that matter, but once I forgave, I started moving away from that and I took steps towards a better, brighter life.
Mu by'ukuri hari inkingi zo kubabarira umuntu aba yaciyemo nka counseling.
There are of course different pillars of forgiveness that one goes through, including also having some kind of counseling in the process.
Nkora muri Soles no muryango uhumuriza urabanza ugahumuriza umuntu mbere yuko umubwira ibyo kubabarira.
I work for Soles Ministries, which is a counseling organization as well. It does counseling as well as an organization. And before it even tells you something about forgiveness, first of all, it tries to console you in your sorrow.
Ugakurikizaho kumurenganura bwa butabera twavugaga. Advocacy.
And it does advocacy also in seeking justice. We talked about justice earlier.
Noneho hagakurikiraho kumufasha social economic empowerment.
And of course it does also help in socioeconomic empowerment of survivors.
Ni nabyo hano muri iki gihugu hari umuryango witwa Mukomeze. Iyo bamaze guhumurizwa abantu bakomeretse urabafasha mu byo korora mu byo mu burezi mu buhinzi muri sponsorship urabafasha noneho umuntu akumva ari umuntu agatangira gutekereza iby'ubuzima.
Whilst people have been, of course, consoled in their sorrow, there are also involvement of other partners. Like in this country particularly, we have, for example, a very good partnership of Mukomeze organization, which operates here. Of course, you have seen Anne-Marie de Brouwers and among many others who are here. It does help then in the socioeconomic sphere in helping people who are in that process of moving forward to make steps towards a brighter future. I think we are getting signs from Rianne.
wa muntu ukamushyira muri famiye nkuko Soresa ari alternative family ukamushyira mu nk'umuryango w'abanyeshuri nkuko se twaje nka famiye ibyo nabyo bimuha kubabarira.
What Mukomeze and similar organization, what they do basically also is somehow to provide alternative families to those who have been consoled, who are in the process of moving forward. Even being here is having a family in a sense, because then people really move forward because they have other support structures around them. And thanks to Mukomeze, you tend to have quite a lot of people who make those steps. Forgiving means that basically you don't seek vengeance, but instead it leads towards some kind of reconciliation path.
Kubabarira bituma na wa wundi wagize nabi aca bugufi agahindukira kaba umuntu.
Forgiving also implies that the person who did the wrong somehow is brought to think further and probably become a person again.
Twabasuye muri gereza ndi kumwe n'abavandimwe bamwe hano.
We visited some of those who committed the crime in jails together with some of the persons who are present here today.
Abababariwe ubona batakikanga ngo abe yanakwica nawe ahunga ahubwo ukabona aratuje.
Persons, for example, who have received forgiveness seem to be a little bit, or to act or react differently from those who didn't, because once they see you, they no longer run away, but instead they look pretty much at peace.
Kandi nabo baricuza nahoze mvuga ngo iyi foto uwayerekamana se akamubwira ati wiciye Beata mama Lambert waramwiciye none mu byukuri sindi genyine mfite ababyeyi mfite abavandimwe mfite abana nta mfite ndakikijwe aricuza akabona yarakoreye ubusa.
But also think of the fact that they also end up being remorseful in the sense, because just thinking about this picture, if I took this picture and showed it to Manasseh, basically he will get the idea that, he will understand that I'm no longer alone. I have a different family now, even a bigger family. Even this also would make me forgive, in a sense.
Ntabwo umugambi yashakaga wo gutsemba yawugezeho niyo mpamvu mbabarira nkuko n'Imana ibidutegeka nkavuga ngo reka noneho nange ngira ikiguzi ntanga kugira ngo ubuzima bwanjye bw'imbere bube bwo nkababarira.
In a sense, of course, he did not achieve what the goal was, which was to exterminate us. And for that also, the fact that I survived means also that I should forgive in order to move forward and have a bright future, including for both of us and the wider society. Forgiving is absolutely necessary in order for a country again to get alive. It also revives life in your own being.
Murakoze,
thank you.
Stay here. Thank you so... Oh, I don't need this, by the way. I have one. Thank you so much, Mama Lambert, for your very impressive and inspiring story. And we learn a lot from your story, not only how difficult it is to follow a process of forgiveness, but also how rewarding it can be. And in the discussion that we will have now, we want to focus in particular on the role of religion, in your case Christianity, in that process. So I will ask first our experts and maybe come back to you in a minute. Now I need this one. So according to your expert opinion, what role does religion play both in individual processes of forgiveness but also collective? As Mama Lambert mentions, it's also important for society at large. So both individual and collective. Can you enlighten us?
Yeah, I would like to say that Madame Lambert has said a lot of wise things about forgiveness, first of all, the definition of forgiveness is that that is a pro-social action, reaction, in fact, on an injustice, on something that is done to you, the harm you have done. It's a pro-social. It means that you, first of all, has in mind the harmony between you and the wrongdoer. That's not easy, in fact, because then you have to, that's what Madame Lambert has said, in the first place she had feelings of revenge. And that's a normal reaction. A normal reaction to harm doing is retaliation. You fight back. But then later on, there is a, let us say, that you reduce, that you inhibit those feelings of revenge. That means that you have control over your feelings that initiate that revenge. And that is very important. In all research that has been done on the basis of forgiveness, executive control, control over your impulses, is essential for forgiveness. And that's what we heard from Madame Lambert, that, not in the beginning maybe, because that's it. Now, okay, that's a very important thing. I can tell more about it, but how is religion now involved in all those things? We, in our Western individualistic society, the definition of what we think is just, our fair, is derived from the Protestant ethic. The idea that if you do good, you will get back good. If you do wrong, you will get back wrong. The Catholic thoughts are less prominent on this. That means that for a Protestant, forgiveness is possible only if there is something that the person who the offender gives something back. Forgiving only for the forgiving is not a Protestant, comes not forth from the Protestant ethic, from the Protestant religion, far less than from the Catholic religion. That means that forgiveness is only effective in this view if the perpetrator makes amends, makes excuses, gives satisfaction to the victim. And in the Catholic religion, that tendency is far less. It's not empty, it is not nothing, but it is less than in the Protestant ethic.
And does your research also show that people who are able to forgive also are able or will find justice sooner? Is there a relation between how you sense justice if you are more forgiving or have been able to forgive?
No. You can forgive, but once again, if the other person does not respond, then forgiveness is less likely. That means that there is a balance between what you give and what the other gives to you. That must be something that is equal.
Mm-hmm. And on a societal level, because now you are referring more to the maybe individual level as well, what is the potential or the consequence for society if forgiveness is not part of a reconciliation process or rebuilding society?
An interesting example about this is how a community can proceed if a wrongdoing is punished or is in another way reconciled. In the 1870s, in the United States, the Sioux Indians, a band of it, there was a chief, and the chief was Spotted Tail. And Spotted Tail took the wife of a disabled member of the clan and took her as his second wife. Crow Dog, was against it, and he was presenting the disabled husband to get something done with a spotted tail. Accidentally, they met each other on the street, and Crow Dog killed Spotted Tail. The thing was that this was an Indian conflict. So the jurisdiction of the United States was not applicable in this case. So the Indians settled this on their own way. And that is, there came a peacemakers, and the peacemakers punished, or what you call it, Spotted Dog, by he had to give $600 to the husband, plus 8 horses, plus a blanket. And that was it. And in this way, the harmony in the group, in the clan, was restored. If, in this case, the United States was punishing juridically in a penal court this man, the whole community would collapse. So this is a way that the community, with reconciliation, with, let's say, forgiveness, keeps the harmony in the group.
The first question that I also posed to your colleague, can you answer that as well, the role of religion, both individual
and
collective?
Yeah, both. In particular, obviously, my main interest here is talking about the perspectives of the victims. So, you know, I have looked in depth at the issues of unity and reconciliation, and of course unity and reconciliation being huge parts of the strategy of Rwanda to overcome the issues stemming from the genocide 21 years ago. And I've got just 3 very short quotes which will all tell you probably a very similar story here when it comes to the notion of forgiveness to begin with. And I will move on to religion, but talk about forgiveness first of all. Mm-hmm. So these are quotes from some of the survivors. The first one here from a survivor, Pierre Gavubi. There's no way unity and reconciliation will come out of politics. So the first question then, if not out of politics, where can unity and reconciliation come from? The second one, which I've got here somewhere,
final page.
Yeah. And this is quite important because we talked earlier on briefly about the fact that not all victims, for example, have the same notion of justice. But very importantly, the same person goes through various transformations, of course, and not even necessarily in a linear form. People can have different perceptions of justice depending on the environment they're in at any given time. So one of the survivors here said, you know, I feel that unity and reconciliation are things we ought to achieve, but sometimes I feel like forgiving, and sometimes not. Now, that's the same person, saying that sometimes they feel like forgiving and sometimes they don't. So you've got these issues of, you know, and a thread runs through a number of survivor stories in terms of not believing. Believing, rather, in unity and reconciliation, but not believing it's something that can be achieved if it's something that's told to an individual, that unity, reconciliation, forgiveness have to be something that comes from the heart, that the individual genuinely believes they want to forgive. Now, with that being said, then, if it doesn't come from the state, where does it come from? And one of the people that we talked to in Rwanda was Bishop John Rukyuhana, who is the chairman of the Faith and Reconciliation Commission in Rwanda. And he said something which actually more than one person I've heard say, but he said something very very meaningful. He said that you know, these effects that are left on survivors, they're not scars. You know, quite often you hear about people being battle-scarred and scars. He said they're not scars. The problem is they're still wounds, and wounds need to be healed. So the question is, how do you heal those wounds? Now, I'm paraphrasing here, but what the bishop said was that, you know, you can't tell a child who was 8, 9, 10 years old during the genocide that you can't tell them, well, you know, come on, it's been 20 years, you've got to forgive. That person is still a young adult. You can't tell somebody who has lost their mother, who has lost their father, who might have lost their brothers, sisters, that they must forgive. Now, that's not to say they can't forgive in the future, but they've got to go through some sort of transformation on the way to get there.
Mm-mm. And does the research that you have done also indicate that if a person is able to forgive, that it will diminish feelings of revenge or anger or all these feelings that keep you maybe in your victimhood? Is that something that you can...
Yes, because, well, the underlying issue here is that when it comes to religion, or really any faith, to be honest, the whole notion of religion, whether it's Christianity, whether it's Islam, whether it's Judaism, whatever the religion is, the whole notion is that it's a transformation that you can see beyond where you are now to some sort of betterment, whether it's in your lived future, whether it's in any afterlife that any religion perceives. And, you know, the only way that you can achieve that is through constant betterment, bettering yourself as an individual. And, you know, notions of forgiveness are strong in all religions. Now, depending on whether an individual will be able to heal themselves will quite often depend on the strength of that faith that they have in that religion. But the stronger the faith in the religion, the more likelihood is that the forgiveness will be genuine.
But for you, if a person is not religious, and what makes a person able to forgive or not, leaving aside the religious part, what is it in your own characteristics or in your own network that will be able or will enable you to be forgiving? As a social psychologist, you've done lots of research there.
The forgiveness is higher when the relationship between the victim and the perpetrator is valued by the victim. Then forgiveness is far higher than when the victim does not that value the relationship. Secondly, as I explained earlier, is that you have to inhibit your impulses. If you are able to do that, only then you can forgive. Otherwise, revenge, retaliation comes up. Third, it's accountability. If you think that the other is less accountable for the atrocities, then you are more inclined to forgive than you think that the other person does it really purposefully, etc. So these are the three important things that people use. No, not people use, but when forgiveness is more likely than in other situations. Mm-hmm. So it is, let's say, in that sense, it's not so much religion in this research, but religion might come in to change this intricate relationship between forgiveness and the other factors.
Mm-mm. May I ask you, Mama Lambert? You mentioned that there should be something in it for both parties, and it should be sincere. How did you determine when you first encountered the perpetrators of the killings of your loved ones? How did you determine that it was a sincere apology and that you could be able to start this forgiving process?
So nirya arakubaje ngo niryari wabyumvise wemeye ko cyangwa niba ariko byagenze urundi ruhande narwo koko kenezo mbabazi kandi ubisaba mu byukuri
nkuko nabibabwiye kubabarira nabyo bifite inyungu bifite akamaro kuwahemukiwe iyo ababari yararuhuka Gambere na mbere rero nanjye ubwanjye ngomba kuruhura umutima wanjye n'intekerezo cyanjye ntibiyoberwe na wa wundi.
As I said, first forgiveness has at first a benefit for the person who was wronged. Like in my case, when I forgave, I was at peace. So I had somehow a peace of mind once I forgave.
Ibitekerezo n'ibikorwa byanjye ntibiyoborwa na wa wundi yavugisha ukuri atavugisha ukuri icyo ndeba ni nanjye ubwanjye ni ukuruhura umutima wanjye nkata sinkomeze kubana nawe ngo nyoborwe nawe.
So from this side of looking at it is that the idea that by forgiving I'm no longer basically haunted by that person, so he's no longer preoccupies all of my mind. Sorry, I asked for the other side then of the equation, and she says that what shows that somehow he was sincere, in fact he was sincere, was that he was spontaneous in showing where the bodies were buried, and he denounced other people she wasn't aware of who participated in the killings, and that gave indication that the other side was somehow sincere.
Okay, thank you.
There are some important things. First of all, in the literature and the research we did on forgiveness, it was never mentioned. We did not investigate the fact that forgiveness might mean that you are not haunted by the perpetrator. We did not. That's a new element in our thought. Maybe it's something to do further. In the second place, you are at peace at heart if you forgive. That's fine. But in our research, we showed that if the perpetrator does not make amends, does not make excuses, does not do any sort of handwriting, hand giving to the victim, forgiven has negative effects for the victim because it lowers self-respect. Because the offender does not react. On the other hand, it gives negative effects for the offender because he does not react. He thinks what he is doing is fine, no problem. He goes on. So there must be, will forgiveness be effective, and for the victim as well as the offender? The offender must make a move. Mm-mm.
Final word for you before I close this part of the session.
Yeah, I think one of the areas that maybe has been touched on, but not so much specifically, is that in some cases, some victims will be happy with not necessarily forgiving those perpetrators for whatever crime. In some cases, it simply is a recognition that the crime actually happened, the recognition they were actually a victim at all. And in some cases, that is enough for the victim, just that recognition of what happened. And again, it's one of the things that you see through a number of areas of victimology and victimization, but in particular in Rwanda, that often the whole notion of things like, for example, genocide denial and the idea that somebody was not a victim actually quite often hurts just as much as a secondary form of victimization than whatever act actually took place in the first place. Mm-hmm. And sometimes to actually gain that peace and sometimes justice can simply be that recognition that somebody truly was an innocent victim, mm-hmm. and that somebody indeed was in fact a perpetrator.
And we could still also have very interesting discussions, but I see you sitting there still, about the role of the international community. As you asked, they were not there in the period to end the genocide. Later on, this same international community set up the Rwanda Tribunal. So how does that... Do people indeed see that in Rwanda as a legitimate reaction to provide justice, but that unfortunately will take us another hour, so I will have to leave that discussion, which I think is very interesting, to the drinks later on. Is that okay for you as well? And you will be the expert to discuss that with you. Because I want to close this part of the session, and I want to give Mama Lambert the final minute to give a take-home message, as we call it, before we go to the really final part of the evening. Mama Lambert, if you want, you can already sit there.
Yeah. Message nkuru nabaha ya mbere no kurwanya ikibi cyose aho cyaba kiri cyane cyane ikintu cyitwa genocide cyane cyane ni nabyiza ko muri urubyiruko n'abantu bakuru bakaba babibuza batoya genocide ni ikintu kibi cyane amarorerwa.
The first thing I would probably tell you would be that I see a lot of young people here. Probably it would be a good thing probably to dedicate your lives in fighting wrongs, especially atrocious wrongs like a genocide. A genocide is a very horrible thing, as you probably may know. And probably those older people here can teach younger ones, or vice versa, how to fight that.
Ubwo twari muri mu sinagogue ubushize hari umuntu wari uri muri twe arabaza atari kwiteka ko muvuga ngo never again bikongera bikaba muba muri mu biki.
The last time I was here, we had a commemoration in a synagogue here in Tilburg. Someone in the audience asked, why do you always keep repeating never again and never again, but it happens again? What do you mean by that? Does it mean anything at all?
Nige ni mwe ni twe bo kubirwanya ntihazagire genocide subira.
But in order to translate that in reality, it's me, it's you who should ensure that actually it means something.
Ijambo tahana cyangwa se nange ntahana ubutabera ni inkingi y'amahoro arambye.
The other thing I would say would be that I believe that justice is a pillar of lasting peace.
Ubutabera ni inkingi y'amajyambere. Hari ubutabera umuntu akora yisanzuye amajyambere akihuta.
But also justice is a pillar of self-empowerment or empowerment, generally speaking. Call it empowerment or development.
Igihugu kitagira ubutabera kiba cyapfuye nta buzima.
A country without justice is probably a dead country or a moribund country.
Ndagira ngo nongere mbabwire two kwitiranya kubabarira no kwibagirwa. Kubabarira si ukwibagirwa.
A third thing I would say would be that there is a difference between forgiving and forgetting. Forgiving is not forgetting.
Ahubwo kubabarira ni ukudakundira kw'ibitekerezo byawe n'ubuzima bwawe byagengwa n'umwanzi cyangwa waguhemukiye ugahora ari uriho uhugiyeho wirukaho ahubwo ni ukuvanamo umujinya yaguteye ibibazo yaguteye ukareba uko wabirenga n'icyo nakwita kubabarira ariko si ukwibagirwa.
So to me, forgiving is basically getting rid of all of those negative feelings, ideas, and thoughts that you get by being haunted always by the wrongdoer. So for me, that is forgiving, not forgetting. Mm-mm. Thank you very much. Murakoze.